So our topic today is breaking the rules of sublimation, a topic that I really love because I like to break the rules. But talking about following the rules to begin with, you know, many business owners never give a lot of thought to challenging the rules set down by others. You come in new to the business, you're a little bit unsure of what to do, and people say, oh, do this, don't do that, and a lot of new business owners just go ahead and follow that. Usually that's not a bad thing to do, okay? Following those rules, hopefully it'll get you past any roadblocks and keep things going along. But the reality is a lot of the so-called rules are not always carved in stone, okay? And that's one of the things to think about. As you become more familiar with what you're doing, especially with sublimation, you want to pay more attention to, you know, all the different parameters. And if you want to start thinking outside the box a little bit, that's great. Start thinking about, you know, what if this, I tried this, or what if I tried that? Worst you can do is fail, right? Okay, so when it comes to the rules, especially with product decoration, they really are more like guidelines, and a lot of them are very good guidelines. We're going to look at the most common things that we go through, and you're going to see some things there. You can challenge them all you want, but you're probably going to lose. But there's other things where you can do some manipulation and maybe get something unique, a little bit different than what everybody else has out there. So that's what I call breaking the rules. It's really more of challenging the guidelines, challenging the accepted wisdom, okay, to see if maybe you can do something a little different or go outside the box, okay? And if you do succeed, okay, if you do succeed, you can probably get some unique products that maybe your competition doesn't have, okay? And that, of course, leads to more money. But by the same token, many have crashed and burned as well, been there, done that. So just because you challenge the rules doesn't mean you'll successfully beat the rules. But certainly, if you're using a scientific methodology, you may be able to work around a few things out there. Okay, so I always suggest to people, push your boundaries. You know, the worst you can do is spend a little extra money. Okay, why don't you want to hear that? Of course, but really, you know, experimentation is the genesis of genius in the world of digital decoration. I've been around the world of decoration for about 25 years, and let me tell you, I mean, there were so many things I was told that couldn't be done 25 years ago that people do routinely all the time now, okay? Things are always changing, and new things are coming out. Sometimes it's just new products out there that help you get by some of those limitations. So don't be afraid to experiment a little bit, see kind of what happens, all right? So the basic rules of sublimation look like this. And if you're a newcomer to this, you may have had these things hammered into your head. I did. I was told it only works on white, and they emphasize only, okay? I was told it only works with polymer fibers, and we emphasize only, okay? It requires exact production settings. Everybody said 400 degrees for 1 minute with a medium pressure. You can't deviate. I mean, I was told that, okay? I was told that you can't use this on outdoor products. It's not UV resistant, therefore you cannot use it on outdoor products, so stay away from them. These are things that I was told. And you can only sublimate on flat surfaces, okay? Because heat presses are flat, right? And it only works on manufactured products. I mean, as far as, you know, it has to have a polymer surface, and you can only work with a limited number of manufactured products. These are the basic rules of sublimation that you get told over and over again. And the reality is, can we get beyond some of these things? So can we work around them? Sometimes we can't change them, but we can work around them, as you'll see as we go through here. So let's start off with the only works on white concept, because with the only works on white, you know, you hear this over and over again. The reality is white is the best color. It is definitely not the only color. It is the best color. Now, it's not just the best color for sublimation. It's also the best color for any form of digital printing. And here's why. The number one reason why is that most digital-based inks are semi-transparent or even transparent. And sublimation dye definitely is transparent. Because if you think about a dye actually goes into the fiber. So it goes into the surface in the case of a shirt. If you're looking at some of the pigment inks, if you look at direct-to-garment printing, it's a semi-transparent because it's actually bonding to the surface rather than getting inside the surface. If you look at something like screen printing, it completely blacks out most of the background so that the background has not so much effect on the screen printing ink. But sublimation dye goes into the surface, therefore the color of the surface will affect the color of the dye. So white's going to give us the best color. It's going to give us the most brilliant colors. It's going to give us the best clarity. It's going to give us the best detail. Okay, it definitely is the best color, but it's not the only color. Okay, with the dye process, and especially with the CMY printing process, with CMY printing, the inks themselves, the digital inks themselves, act like filters. Because when we put that ink onto the surface, what we're doing is white light is the combination of all colors. So if we project white light onto a surface that's white, of course you're going to see white, but if you're projecting it onto the surface where we've put the CMY inks on there, it hits the surface and it bounces back out. And when it bounces back out, the colors of those inks that are on there act as filters. And what they do is they actually hold back some colors and let other colors pass through. So the colors of the ink combined with that white color surface are affecting the light that your eyes actually see. Sounds a little abstract, but that's really kind of the way that it works there. Therefore, we start talking about the background color. The background color is in itself, when white light hits the background, let's say blue, what's being reflected off that background is mostly blue light. That's why we see blue. So then if we're running blue through the ink that we put on there, the ink is not starting with white light. It's starting with blue light, and then you're seeing is an altered color. So that's why we say white is the best color. It's not the only color. Okay, and that's important to remember. Light colors can definitely be sublimated. But when we do light colors, we have to be careful that the colors of the ink may not look the same as when we did it on a white colored surface. As well, in general with sublimation, we always have to have darker ink colors than the background color. Okay, so if you're using lighter colors, they're probably not going to show up. Now, believe it or not, you can actually sublimate black. You just can't see it, okay, so it doesn't work, all right? But the reality is we can't do light colors, but there may be some effect on your image color, and therefore your image colors may have to be edited, modified, or whatnot to work with some of the different color surfaces. But sure, we can do colors, okay, within reason there. And some colors definitely work better than others. For example, heather, gray heather, you would think would be a very easy, almost neutral color. Works pretty good with logos, but, you know, with photos, it can be challenging. So you do have to experiment a little bit with some of these different colors to kind of see what kind of works and what doesn't, right? All right. So as I said, the dye must be darker than the surface, significantly darker than the surface. So we can actually do a red shirt with black ink, but you're probably not going to do a red shirt with pink ink. That's just not going to come out right, okay? But truly on darks, as I said, you can sublimate darks. You just can't see them. The way that darks are traditionally done in the industry with DTG printing, with screen printing, is to actually put down an artificial layer of white. And see, that's the interesting thing about it. They talk about with those systems that we can print on darks, but rarely do they print directly on dark. What they'll do is they'll actually put down some type of white surface first using a specialized ink designed for this purpose, and then they put all the color on top of it. So the reality is they're still printing on white because white is the best color, but they had the ability with DTG and with screen printing to put down an artificial layer of white first and then build the design on top. Unfortunately, we cannot do that with sublimation. Sublimation being a dye is dependent on, first of all, being able to penetrate into the fibers of the surface rather than being applied to the surface. So the white ink is not going to work for us, unfortunately. And that becomes a bit of a limitation. Doesn't mean we can't do non-white, but it does limit what type of non-white surfaces we can actually do. The other aspect that comes to mind is we can't reproduce the color white either. If I had a CMY color chart on the screen, you could see all the different, you could see the various combinations of CMY, but there is no combination of cyan, yellow, and magenta that equal white. So, you know, the way that we make white in the world of CMY printing is that we leave the area open that we wish to be white while working with a white surface. So, for example, if you look at the Eagle shirt, the Eagle itself is sublimated into the shirt, but the white areas are left open so that the shirt color makes up for the white. Because it's sublimation, it's below the surface, which means you can't feel the ink. You can't tell whether there's ink there or not by touching it. So, you know, there it works out great. But when we put it on the blue shirt, two things happen. Number one, everywhere that you want it to be white is now the color blue because we left the areas white as no color areas. So you can see it's blue. Secondly, you can see that the image itself is not as brilliant in color as it is here. And because of the difference, that's what leads people to say you can't do anything but white. Well, in this case, white is certainly a better option than this case because the client probably doesn't like a blue neck. Okay, maybe you can market your way around that. You know, I'm pretty good at figuring out little ways to get around that, but whatever. So the bottom line there is, yes, I put it onto a colored surface, but I had some challenges doing it because I don't have the ability to reproduce the color white and therefore to put a white base either. So something to think about. What about non-apparel? You see, all those things we just talked about, they're pretty much apparel because most of the substrates, and Dom will confirm this, most of the substrates out there have a white surface, okay? So let's say, for example, this can be anything. Let's say it's a mouse pad, okay? You go and buy the mouse pad. You call Don and say, hey, Don, I need some mouse pads, okay, or I need this photo panels or whatever. And so you're going to place this order, and they're going to come to you, and they have a white surface. So if you need a black mouse pad, you don't buy a black mouse pad to sublimate it. You buy a white one, and then your graphic is the image you need plus a recolorization of the rest of the surface, okay, like this. You know, we're going to put this wolf on here, and you can see the black, you know, it's a black background. So the background was just part of the image. And so we, you know, didn't start with a black mouse pad. We started with a white one, recolored the total thing, and we left the areas that we needed white open. So 90% of our sublimation is pretty much on substrates that are not apparel. Okay? Depends on who you are. I mean, some of you may be doing a lot more apparel than that, but really, for most people, apparel is 10 to 20% the most of their total business. So therefore, most of our surfaces are white, unless we're looking for special effects. We've got some silver metals out there, for example, which can give us some pretty neat special effects. But most of the things that we're buying are white, so therefore white's not really an issue unless we're talking about apparel. Okay, but you can definitely work beyond that. Now, you may see some things out there, and some of you are well aware of how all-over sublimation works. Some of you are not. Both of these shirts, how do they sublimate them and add white into the logos? Well, in both cases, this is an all-over process where the shirt itself starts out white. You can see the bottom of this one's pulled up, and you can see the inside was white. Look through the collar here. The inside is white. And in both cases, a transfer was made large enough to do the entire front and the entire back. And the transfer itself completely covered the shirt, just like we were doing that mouse pad, completely covered the shirt from edge to edge so that we recolored the shirt and applied the logo at the same time, leaving the white areas open, because the initial color of the shirt was white, and therefore we get that final effect. Now, you can do that on a finished T-shirt, because a finished T-shirt doesn't have a collar to worry about. Both of these shirts were done in a cut-and-sew process because they have finished collars. So you couldn't make a transfer and do the whole front because the collar's in the way. So this was done, you know, in manufacturing where they did the body of the shirt, they did the sleeves of the shirt, and then they sewed the other components on. But still, it all started out as white material, and it was sublimated that way. This involves wide format printers and wide format heat presses, okay, both those items. And if that's something that you have an interest in, definitely talk to Don about it, because Johnson Plastics can help you get into wide format if you feel like that's what you need. If you're not ready to go there yet, there are certainly people you can contract it out to handle it for you. But remember, it takes two components. It takes the big heat press as well as the big printer. All right, next. Next item here on our list is, it only works on polymer fibers, okay? Does it? Or can we do something beyond polymer? Well, it's really all about chemistry. And as much as we really want to do cotton, it ain't going to work. In fact, when we start talking about the whole world of digital inks, inks really have to be chosen based on the application. Think of ink almost like paint. You go to the paint store, you buy wood paint for wood, you buy metal paint for metal. You don't mix the two together. If you do, you won't get proper bonding. There has to be proper bonding between the, you know, the ink or paint and the surface for it to be permanent and not to fade, chip, peel, crack, all those other kind of things. So that all applies to the industry we're in too. And a lot of people keep looking for some type of digital ink that works on every surface. Does not. Okay, that's the reality of it. It's chemistry. It's beyond your control to some degrees. Okay, it's chemistry on how it works. In the chemistry of sublimation, it's sublimation bonds at a molecular level with polymer components, polymer cells, polymer fibers. Okay, that can't be changed. You can't change that aspect of it when it comes to sublimation. It only bonds with polymers. It does not bond with cotton. It does not bond with wood, or cellulose, or metal, or glass or acrylic. It doesn't bond directly with those. It only bonds with polymer fibers, polymer cells, polymer cells, that type. Okay, I mean that's the way it works. It bonds to them, but it does it physically at a molecular level. If you look at some of the processes like pigment inks you'll find in direct-to-garment printing. Pigment inks you'll find in full-color transfers designed for cotton. Okay, and with a pigment-based ink, in order to make the pigment-based ink properly bond with the surface of whatever we're decorating, we use a process called fixation. And fixation requires that binders, you can think of it as adhesives, but that's not really a good word, but binders are chemical properties or chemicals that will allow that ink to bind properly with the surface it's being applied to. The binders are either in the inks, especially with DTG, or possibly in the papers. Sometimes they're in the papers, sometimes they're in both. If you're talking about transfers in the papers and the inks, whereas DTG is just in the ink. If you ever notice with DTG, for example, you put the image on there and you put it under heat press. Why do you do that? People are like, well, that makes it dry. That's not really what it's doing. It's actually fixating it. By applying the heat, it's causing those binding agents to bind to the surface of what's been decorated so it doesn't fade and doesn't crack or peel too soon. Okay, and so that's required. Okay, so that's required for those inks, but not for sublimation. Sublimation being the dye, doesn't require binders. It works on a molecular process. So that's why it's important to understand. You know, the process of decorating cotton is so totally different chemically than it is on polymer fibers. Yes, it only bonds permanently with polymer fibers. Okay, that rule we're not going to change. But how can we work around that? The reality is we have lots of products that you should know by now that do have some type of polymer coating applied to them. And that particular polymer coating, if applied correctly, it itself has to bond with the surface. And then it allows the sublimation to bond with the coating such that you get a permanent bond in there. So you do have to have that polymer surface on there to make it work, or it has to be polyester to make it work. But when we start talking about apparel, what about all the blends out there? Sublimation will not bond with cotton, but it will work with different blends. So if I want to go do a 50-50, for example, sure, I can sublimate a 50-50. It's not going to look the same as 100% poly, but I can do a 50-50 as long as 50% of it's polyester. And it's going to get you sort of a faded, washed, retro, distressed look, any one of those particular titles. Works pretty cool, too, okay? But it's only bonding with those polymer elements. Therefore, you know, you get a bit of a washed look there. So let me see if I can get you a halfway decent image here. When I do these things live, you can look at the shirts and feel them and touch them and see the real difference. On this one, let's see. Okay, you may have to tilt your screen up. If you look at the one on the right-hand side, the one on the right-hand side is on a 50-50 shirt. Also, the one in the bottom of the picture with two. So this one over here is the same as this one. It's just close up here. It, over here is 100% polyester. So if you look at the polyester one, you can see the colors are brighter than they are on the 50-50. So, you know, it has a bit of a washed look. And it's really a little bit more faded than it appears on the screen because, unfortunately, we can't perfect the images on the screen like they are in real person. But that kind of gives you an idea that, yeah, there's going to be a difference there. Now, certain situations, that's to your advantage. If you're trying to get that look, go with 50-50s or 80-20s or whatever. And it's the amount of distress in the image is going to vary based on the percentage of polyester that's in that particular garment. Okay, so you can see this was actually done for a sort of a surf image, and the distress looked awesome. Okay, look absolutely awesome for what we wanted to achieve there. Now, be aware that when you first sublimate something that's 50-50 and you take it off the heat press, that it's probably going to fade a little bit more from what you're looking at. When it first comes off the heat press, you got some sublimation dye that's not really fixated into the fibers, but it's there on the shirt, so it gives it maybe a little bit darker color than it's really going to be after it's washed the first time. So typically when you come off the heat press, you're looking and say, hey, that's pretty good, and you go to wash it, it's going to fade a little bit. Typically only going to fade the first time that you wash it because it gets rid of anything that's not binding in there properly. And you know what? That's something to be aware of because if your customers traditionally bought poly products from you and you properly sublimated them, they shouldn't fade when they wash them. So now when they do a 50-50 and it fades a little bit the first time they wash it, you know, you probably should make them aware of that. But most people are used to that because they're buying cotton T-shirts all day long that fade, fade, fade. So I would encourage you, if you're going to sell 50-50 or blend products, do some test runs and then go wash them and maybe wash them over and over again to make sure that it's fixating properly. And fixation was really the wrong word, sublimation. Make sure it's bonding properly in the case of sublimation. So, you know, go ahead and do a little bit of test runs yourself. That's always important to do. But, yeah, we can do blends. Just want to make sure it's always at least 50% poly. If you go below 50% poly in the fabric, your results get really bad really quick. And you know what else? You can also do blended light colors. Because here's the same image. I actually designed this particular image or set this particular image up to go on washed green and washed tan shirt. So I was looking at a washed shirt with a washed looking image. And again, in person, they're probably a little bit more washed out than they're showing up on your computer. But it really made a great effect for what I wanted to do. So I broke two rules. I used a blended light color shirt. And so that's two rules, blended and color at the same time. And it worked out just perfect. So, you know, there are other blends besides poly and cotton. You'd have to experiment with them. I mean, if you find something that is unique out there, you may just have to go experiment with it. We don't always have answers. I mean, if somebody came up with a 50% bamboo and 50% cotton, I mean poly, and I'm making that up, would that work? You know, somebody asked me one time, well, I was looking at something, it was like nylon and cotton blend. Well, that could be scary because nylon can melt at a much lower point than poly. So you always want to make sure anything you put in your heat press can withstand at least 400 degrees, even though when you do apparel, we normally do apparel slightly less than 400. Apparel is more like, you know, 380 to 385 on average. Not a lot of difference. I mean, you know, if you put your hand on 400-degree press, it feels about the same as a 380-degree press. It burns, okay? But as far as fabric content's concerned, that could be a difference. So you do have to be careful if you go beyond cotton and poly blends, okay? But, hey, experiment, you know? That's what it's all about, right? Okay, one other thing we got to throw in, though. I mean, this is important. I really have to emphasize this. We have more and more manufacturers jumping in and offering polyester shirts for sublimation. And we've all had it drilled into our heads that polyester and sublimation go one in hand in hand, 100%, no problem. The problem becomes, though, that all polyester shirts are not created equally, and that means you may not get the same result. For example, we've come across some shirts that antimicrobial coatings were added in, and that interfered with the sublimation. Other times they didn't, okay? So it's not, you can't say antimicrobials don't work, but we found that some antimicrobials in certain brands, however they were applied or whatever, seemed to have some type of interference with the sublimation. The dye didn't get into the cells properly. Okay. Another thing that's happened, especially with colors, well, actually only with colors, but with light colors, people have come back and reported, listen, I bought XYZ brand, and it was a light pink shirt, and when I sublimated it, when I opened up the press, the whole area that had been under the platen had faded. You know, it wasn't the same color. Well, what happened there was the dye in the shirt, not the sublimation dye. The dye in the shirt was not properly heat set, and it faded from all that heat put on it. Well, you know, there's nothing to fix that. So what I'm getting at is you do have to sample shirts, and you want to find high-quality shirts made for sublimation such that they will not have those type of issues. I mean, there's enough challenges to get a good sublimation or shirt with things like transfer lines that you don't need to have to worry about, you know, other problems along the way. So what I suggest to you is if you're looking at shirts, if you walk into a show and you see somebody selling a shirt, they threw a sign up that says, perfect for sublimation. You know, I would ask them three questions. Number one, have you or someone in your company actually sublimated that shirt before to make sure that it really works? Number two, if you've done so, what are the proper settings for your shirt for sublimation in terms of the heat press? And number three, is there anybody in your staff that I can call to help me out should there be a problem? So, you know, if you're working with reputable dealers who've thoroughly tested the products they're selling, they'll have no problem answering yes to those three questions. Okay? Johnson's a great example. They have such a good staff there that they're going to be able to help you get the right settings and get all your, you know, challenges figured out so that you won't have any challenges. But keep that in mind, because I'm seeing more and more of these pop up, and they really haven't tested them. They just read in a magazine somewhere that polyester works with sublimation. We have a polyester short, therefore it should work for everything out there. And then I briefly mentioned nylon, but nylon in general, nylon and polyester are both thermoplastic polymers, and they look very similar, and they do have very similar properties, but most nylons melt fairly below, fairly well below the melting point for polyester. Therefore, you have to be careful about nylon. And I've got mixed things. I've not been successful in nylon, and I walked away from it because I didn't really have a need for it. But I've had some other people say, yeah, we do nylon, but we do it at a very low heat setting. Well, you got to be careful with sublimation because you drop the heating down too much, it affects the vibrancy of the colors, and it may affect the bonding of the dye into the surface. So you got to be really careful with that. So my question is, why do you need nylon? Number one reason I've heard of people want nylon is flax. And, you know, up until a few years ago, really 2 or 3 years ago, polyester flax are hard to find, but you can find polyester flax now. In fact, I'm telling you, you're looking for something unique. That's one thing about Johnson Plastics is they have a tremendous amount of unique substrates. And if it exists, they probably have it. So if you're having a challenge finding something specific with a customer, call up one of your specialists there at Johnson, see if they can help you out and find that out for you the right way. Okay? Don't go do nylon. It's probably going to be a problem. Well, you can go try it. Just be careful you don't want it melting to your heat press. That becomes a mess. Okay, a couple other things real quick with polyester apparel. Fibers may not be 100% polyester. That's one of the things we've run into as well. We got some of these shirt brands coming out. They're calling themselves a polyester shirt, but they're really like 90% polyester. So they don't get quite the color brilliance they're supposed to. Some of the very lightweight fabrics may bleed through. Never a good thing. Very, very loose knits. I mean, how tight is the knit in the shirt? That can affect the quality of the image. Different brands probably have different settings. I mean, that's the one thing. You get into apparel, you got to really kind of fine-tune it for each particular product that you're doing. And, of course, I mentioned finishes and coatings can interfere with the sublimation. Can you sublimate cotton using pigment paper? See, this was somebody thinking, and I was impressed with a person that tried this out. And they put it on the Internet for everybody to see. Okay? And what they did was they understood about binding agents and fixation. So they had this idea that if I went out and got some of the transfer paper designed for pigment inks, transfer paper for pigment inks has binding agents in it. Transfer paper for sublimation dyes does not, because we don't need binders, right? But they went and got some inkjet transfer paper designed for pigment inks that has the binding agents. And then they printed onto that paper with their sublimation dye, and then they walked over to a cotton shirt, and then they put it under the heat press, and voila, the image transferred into the cotton because the binders helped it to bind to the cotton, or so it would seem, okay? And then they got on the Internet, and they told people, see, and this all of a sudden, that's how I found out about it, because people were calling me and said, hey, this dude just said he can sublimate on cotton. Well, a couple of days later, after he washed it, after someone encouraged him to wash it, he came back and said, oops, it really didn't work. But you got to give them credit for trying. And that's what I'm talking about, you know, experimenting a little bit and kind of seeing what can happen out there. And in that case, you know, it was a good shot. Didn't really work, but it was a good shot. So, you know, and there's some different papers out there. And the guys at Johnson can tell you more about it. What we call opaque transfers, where you're actually sublimating onto a special transfer paper that becomes, I hate to use the word decal, but it becomes a permanent part of the garment. So you're sublimating onto this specific type of paper, and then the back side of the paper actually has adhesives on it. So when we go and place it onto the surface of the garment, it can be a cotton garment, we need to contour cut that transfer paper right up to the edges of the image, and then we'll place it on the surface of whatever we're going to do and put heat on it, and then the adhesives on the back side of this film, is probably a better word than decal, will bond the whole film to the surface. Okay, call those opaque transfers. You want to learn more about that? You can certainly inquire with Don or any of the people there at Johnson on that. Okay, I got told early on, and to the point I almost got scared, that I had to hit 400 degrees for 1 minute with a medium pressure. Okay, and I was afraid to deviate from that. Okay, because people told me that's the only way it works. Well, it's very important to understand that with sublimation, that these are critical factors for making the transfer of the dye occur properly, as well as for it to molecularly bond properly, and as to ensure the vibrancy of the colors. And when we start changing it a whole lot, we may not get what we want. But some things actually are going to require a longer time. And I do encourage people, I said, if you're having problems with things, you don't really like the way it came out. If you feel like the color was a little dull, okay, verify first of all it is 400 degrees. And then maybe you're going to go 70 seconds. You know, maybe you're going to go just a little bit longer and kind of see what happens. Or maybe you're going to increase your pressure just a little bit. You know, any of those things, the longer we can run it in theory, the brighter the colors and the better transfer. But see, there's a point of diminishing returns. You go too long with a lot of things, then it crosses over and goes downhill. So, you know, this is good settings for most things, but some things are going to be some variances in there, okay? So for you, if you're not really liking what's coming out, first of all, keep in mind, depending on the quality of your heat press may not be giving you an accurate output. It may say 400 degrees, so it's really only doing 390, okay? So unless you're routinely checking it, then you know what? You may not be getting true heat that you think you are. So maybe we have to change some things. And then different substrates may require deviation. For example, ceramics. Ceramics are a heat sink, which means they absorb heat in. So you've got to pump a lot of heat on there and keep the heat on there so it fully saturates for it to be able to really get to 400 degrees and maintain it. You know, metals are really quick, but ceramics obviously in the scale. So a lot of times, like for example, a coffee mug in a coffee mug press could be 3 to 5 minutes, depending on your heat press and your mug and whatever else. Okay, what happened to 1 minute? Well, you know, it's the nature of the beast. Same thing with ceramic tiles. A lot of times we're running those longer too because, again, they're heat sinks. They're absorbing the heat, and we have to run it a little bit longer. So that's important. And so because you understand that, then don't be afraid to deviate a little bit. In fact, this is what I tell people to do to get used to sublimation. Go home and get some inexpensive substrates, and, you know, with those particular substrates, see what happens when you vary, you know, some of the settings. For example, just stick with temperature and then take the same item and sublimate it at 400 degrees, 480 degrees, 470 degrees. See what happens so that you get it in your head, you know, how the temperature affects it. Then do the same thing with pressure. Then do the same thing with time, okay? And you can learn a lot. And you're gonna waste some stuff. Okay, you're going to waste some ink, you're going to waste some substrates. But it's a good learning process to get it in your head because you want to get where you can fine-tune stuff and then keep recipes. And then every time you do it, you get a great transfer every time, okay, because you've done a little experiment up ahead of time. You know, apparel transfer lines are a great example of if you use the standards, you're going to screw up, okay? Well, you aren't. The shirt is. Reality is if you use 400 degrees for 1 minute at a medium pressure on a T-shirt, most likely you're going to get transfer lines. And you can clearly see a transfer line here, a little razor thin edge right where the edge of the transfer paper touched into the surface of the shirt. And what really happened here was the fibers of the shirt started to melt right there on the edges. So you get this permanent line you can't get rid of. This is a great example of the proper way to do this without getting into too much detail is that we're going to vary the time, temperature, and pressure and probably use a foam kit as well. By putting the foam underneath, one of the things about the foam is it helps to soften the edges, okay? And the foam really works if you do it the right way. But you got to do that foam, and you also have to set the settings up the right way. For one thing, and this is one of those things that will shock you the first time, is we're going to tremendously reduce the pressure of the heat press if we're going to use the foam and do the shirts. And typically what we'll do is we'll take a piece of this foam. And by the way, the foam is available from Johnson Plastics. We're going to take a piece of this foam, and we're going to put it under the corner of the heat press, and we're going to shut the heat press and latch it, and then adjust the pressure so that we only have compressed that foam by no more than half of its original height, which means the top and the bottom plant don't even touch. Now, see, that freaks a lot of people out. That's never going to work. Yeah, it does work, okay? But that's what I'm talking about. That pressure is extremely light. It's nowhere near that medium pressure that people told you all day long, okay? And then we're going to do even more things that are really twisting things around. Yeah, typical of apparel, and it can vary with brand, okay? But we're going to save 35 to 40 seconds on our time instead of 1 minute. We're going to probably go anywhere from 380 to 390 degrees, but 385 obviously being the center point of that. And that goes against everything people tell you, okay? But this is necessary. Now, you got to be careful, because when you're downgrading these settings, when you're decreasing the settings, you do have a tendency that your image is not going to have quite as brilliant a level of color. But you got to balance between any fading there and any lines that show up, because you can get away with a little bit of fading. You can't get away with those lines there, okay? Can't get away with that, unless you're really good at marketing and you tell people when they have, you know, a rectangle of transfer line around their image and you say, hey, listen, I'm not going to charge you extra this time. This is a new technique we developed called the window effect. And using the window effect is going to draw attention to your logo, so more people are going to notice it on the shirt, and you're going to actually get a better promotional value out of this shirt. Okay, go ahead and see if that works. So in general, if you want to start playing a little bit, there's nothing wrong with increasing your time a little bit, decreasing your time a little bit. Just do it in small ranges, like 10 seconds, okay? We rarely bring the temperature up unless they're, you know, sometimes there actually is a heat press issue and we'll bring it up. But a lot of items, you know, 400 degrees is really on the edge of melting polyester. So we really rarely go up higher on temperature. And if we do, probably no more than about 410. So it's normal to bring it down some, but really not take it up. Pressure can go up or down. You know, in 40 PSI, I know most of you don't have a PSI indication on your heat press, but you're talking about medium pressure. Medium pressure is when an average person can lock it down without breaking their back, okay? So you should be able to easily push it down and latch it. That's pretty much medium pressure. How vague was that? Okay, then I got told it can't be used on outdoor products. Why? Because it's not UV resistant. Okay, another physical factor of the chemistry. Sublimation is not UV resistant. All right, so does that mean you can't use it on outdoor products? I mean, really, what doesn't fade in sunlight? You know, pretty much every paint, ink, and dye will fade over time. Okay, there's one thing that doesn't fade in sunlight, and I was at the award show back in January, and I made that comment. What doesn't fade in sunlight? And the guy raised his hand. He's, you know, he makes trophies and awards. He says, engraving. Like, good point, okay? But other than engraving, when we're talking about full-color imaging, pretty much everything is going to fade in direct sunlight. It's just how fast or slow. Okay, how fast or slow. So the reality is, if you know it's going to fade, you have to tell the customer. Because if you're honest and tell the customer, you're managing their expectation. That's an important aspect. It isn't that fading is so bad, it's managing the expectation of fading. Think about fading as a recurring income. That's the way I like to put it. Because if it does fade, they got to replace it. Now, I'm not going to try to sell somebody a nice sign to go outside their office in direct sunlight. You know, if it's in direct sunlight 8 hours a day, it's going to fade a lot faster than if it's in partial sunlight a few hours a day. Okay, so we really can't predict how fast it's going to fade. But a lot of people try to use a rule of thumb of about 2 years. And I'm not going to tell you if something's going to last 2 years or not, okay, because I don't know. Depends on the environmental conditions. But the main thing about the fading is it's gradual enough that you don't notice it as it's, you know, fading. You don't notice the degrees of fading, right? So you want to be upfront and honest with the aspects. But then you start turning it around and say, hey, listen, you know what? If this license plate you pull in the car is going to last 2 years, you need another one in 2 years. You know, I know somebody does police departments, and she does license plates for the police department. You know, they got, I don't know, 100 squad cars or whatever. And, you know, she told them, I said, hey, you probably have to get new license plates because they're going to fade about every 2 years. They understand fading. The decals fade on the cars, the interiors fade on the cars, and they usually trade their cars about every 2 years anyway. So they're like, oh, okay, there's their expectation, is that in 2 years they needed more license plates. It's an expectation. So, you know, they knew in advance, they responded to it. Same thing with memorial products. We do have people put memorial products on tombstones and are asking, you know, how long is this going to last? Not forever, okay? And so the enterprising people will actually sell like three memorial plaques together in a package of three and tell the family it's going to fade and you periodically want to replace it, you know, as it fades, so you will sell it to you in sets of three. So what they did was they took a weakness and they turned it into a positive. And that's what we're talking about. There's a memorial product there. That's what we're talking about, is taking a weakness and turning it into a strong point. It's bad to hide weaknesses. It's much better to bring them out in the open and turn them into something that's beneficial all the way around. And then you can only sublimate flat surfaces, right? Well, pretty much. look at a heat press. Okay, a heat press is flat. But there are a few exceptions to being able to just do flats. You know, we have mug presses. They've been around a long time. for coffee mugs. And you know what? You can fit some other things in a mug press, like some water bottles. You just need to experiment and make sure it fits within the diameter. Another way of doing round items is, especially with mugs, is to use mug wraps, where we actually wrap a physical component around the mug that holds the transfer against the mug, and then you put it in a convection oven. Well, those things have been expanding because not only are they being used for mugs now, they're making them for bigger stuff, and that means that new products are coming into the marketplace because we're able to wrap them and put them into a convection oven. So some cylindrical items that we can do. There's another process, and we'll talk to I'll ask Don about it when Don comes back in here in just a minute. There are some other processes that are still kind of new out there, and I haven't seen a lot of it in the U.S. yet, but there are some new presses on the horizon called 3D presses that will allow you to do some oddly shaped items. But I'm not positive if they're available in the U.S. yet, and we'll see what Don knows on that. But keep in mind, technologies are changing, and you may be able to do some of those things coming up. So don't feel completely limited to flats. Experiment a little bit and say, here's something that's interesting. Remember, it has to have polymer coating, but whatever. So the final thing is it only works for manufactured products. Now, I'm a big proponent of telling you, just go out and buy the manufactured products, okay, because it makes it a lot easier. But people ask all the time, can I do my own coatings? Yeah, there are some products out there where you can do your own coatings. What you need to keep in mind, and I don't want to squelch your creativity, but you need to keep in your mind that taking a spray can of something and spraying it onto something does not make you have a great coating, okay? Because, for example, if you've ever done any spray painting, what happens when you spray paint? You'll notice that you got runs and you got gaps. Okay, especially when you're doing, two, like red on white, you can clearly see here that that's a very uneven spray painting. So what happens if you're trying to do spray coatings onto something, especially if you're trying to put a clear coat type of spray coating onto something, can you even begin to tell how good that coating is? Your coating has to be consistent in coverage, in depth, and you really have to do it well or it's going to affect the sublimation. Sublimation is only going to be as good as that particular coating. In fact, I've seen some coating kits that are a three-part process where you're putting down a primer first because you want to make sure that your coating actually bonds to the surface of what it is you're coating. And they actually have a primer first that goes down, and then they'll have an underlayer, and then they'll have a top layer. So it's like a three-part process, and it has to cure in between each one. If you ever get a chance to go visit some of the people that do coatings, I mean, it's amazing how much work goes into getting a good coating on there because you've got to make sure that the coating is consistent and the coating itself has made a permanent bond to whatever it is that we're coating. So if you think you're going to pick up a can and just spray it and get great results, you're probably not. Are there people out there doing their own coatings? They are. And every one of them will tell you that they spend a lot of time experimenting and there are a lot of challenges involved with it. Okay? So, set your expectations accordingly on that. The nice thing about finished substrates is that there are so many out there and new ones coming out all the time. I know for some reason people think, too, that if they do their own coatings, the substrate becomes cheaper. But it's not. By the time you buy the coating materials, all the time you spend, I mean, why would you spend, 30 minutes to get the coating right on a cell phone cover when you could just pick up the phone and order a cell phone cover that's already been coated professionally? I mean, why would you do that? But I do understand if you have something very unique and nobody offers a coating for it or whatnot, where you may want to go with that. Just be aware that it's not as easy as it may seem, okay? So there's no reason without experimenting. So, anyway, the reality is that we do have the ability to kind of play around with some of the so-called rules of sublimation. A lot of the rules are really defined by chemistry and physics. We can't bend them but so much. But I'm never against trying to experiment a little bit, and definitely experiment and document. When you start changing things like settings, you want to do it in very – you don't want to change. You got three settings on your heat press. Don't change all three at the same time. You want to change one because you want to know what it did. If you changed all three, you wouldn't know which one actually made the difference, okay? So you want to experiment and document. You want to keep notes on things that you do. And you want to be able to repeat it. That's the key. You want to be able to repeat exact settings every single time. So be patient. Try things out. Wash apparel multiple times. See what happens. UV coatings, and I didn't mention that when we're talking about the UV, but you know, people ask all the time, can't you just spray it with something to protect it? It's not that simple. Don may have a solution. I don't for UV coatings. But I know that one thing about it, for you to test it, it's going to take you a long time because you got to coat it and go stick it in the sun for the next 2 years to see what happens. So that one's just not another automatic given either. Okay, you can learn a lot more about sublimation. If you're new to this, I suggest that you do visit the Johnson Plastics website, which is johnsonplastics.com, and they have a really nice area of sublimation support that will lead you to all kinds of things like tips and templates and training and videos and webcasts and just a lot of good information there that can help you learn a little bit more and maybe help you play around if you want to go out and try and break the barriers a little bit. You may find some good information there that can help you out. So, you know, I do encourage you to visit their website, learn as much as you can there. And with that said, I'm going to bring Don back out, and we'll take some of your questions here. I know Don has a few things he wants to present to you. So Don, you still there?
Yeah. Thanks a lot, Jamie. That was awesome. Yes, everybody, appreciate you coming this afternoon. Just one thing I want to mention to you, ask you a couple things. NBM Philadelphia, September 19th, 20th, and 21st at the Philadelphia Convention Center. And the for attending today's seminar, good for 1 week, and column pricing. So that should help everybody get some of the new products that we have to offer in for testing.
Excellent. You know, it's
good, Jimmy.
I know we're sitting here in August, and so most people are ramping up with their back to school and whatnot, and that's good. Okay, I mean, you really need to be on that because, you know, the schools have started, and some have started, another one starting next week. But don't forget Christmas. I know people don't want to hear about Christmas in August. You're sitting there sweating, and you're saying, what, are you kidding me? But really, you don't want to think about Christmas in November. You want to start thinking, when you get past the school deals, you want to start ramping into Christmas. And the sooner you can think about that, the better. And September, you know, is a great time for that. So, again, you know, looking at the new products that Don's talking about and starting to say, hey, how can I fit this in my mix? Because, you know, Christmas isn't just about making, you know, personalized products, which are really good. But, you know, a lot of corporations give out holiday gifts of some sort, which are really promotional products in disguise. And, you know, you definitely want to be looking at those ideas because you want to start pitching it, you know, in September and early October to those types of clients. So take a look at, you know, all the new products that Don's referencing with Johnson Plastics, you know, because you guys just have a tremendous – how do you keep up with all that stuff? You got so many different things.
Oh. Yeah, I just saw today that we've actually added another license plate to the mix. A little more inexpensive, but it works.
Yeah. Okay. Couple of questions here. Let's see. What ink should be used for cell phone inserts? Well, yeah, if they're sublimatable, sublimation ink. Don, which cell phone inserts are you guys carrying? Which brand?
At the present time, Jimmy, we are carrying the Unisub product.
Okay. Yep. And that's a good product. What's the cost on a blank cell phone cover?
I think at the end of the day, the customer can have probably $4 for 20, four and a quarter in finished product.
Yeah.
That's blanks, ink, and everything.
Yeah, and here's what's the important part. If you're one of those people that takes that $4.25 and doubles it, see, that's kind of like old school, you know, cost times two. You'd be selling it for $8.50, and you would be silly. See, I'm using a nice word. You would be silly to do that because if it's personalized, you know, with someone's picture or whatnot, especially if it's like a baby photo or whatever, you know, this personalized cell phone coverage, they retail all day long for $30. And, you know, that's a tremendous margin because it's not so much that you sublimate it, good thing, but it's what you put on there. And you got to remember that. So those are great products, man. Great products. Let's see. Don, are you familiar with 3D heat presses?
Yeah, some of the there's a couple of them on the market out there. I don't know that they've they have infiltrated the United States. The biggest problem with the 3Ds is the products to use on them. I don't know that they've got something or a huge catalog of products to use with those 3D.
Yeah.
That would be the issue.
I think it has to evolve. you're going to have the press, and then people are going to start doing some of the new different products, and, you know, it'll kind of build from there. And, you know, because someone asked, can you sublimate a curved surface such as a golf ball? Now, I'm not familiar with sublimating a golf ball. I mean, I know ways to print on a golf ball. But have you ever seen any way to sublimate a golf ball?
No, but just, you know, the customer has to remember at the end of the day, that product has to have a coating to accept it.
Yes, absolutely.
You know, absolutely. And, you know, when you mentioned UV stuff, I've got some customers that are they're taking a Krylon polyester and spraying onto the arms of an Adirondack chair.
Right.
Curing it somehow with maybe a heat gun or what have you, and sublimating on that thing, which doesn't indeed work, but, yeah, it's outside and here today, gone tomorrow.
So you're selling some coating materials?
No, we aren't, no.
Oh, okay.
Some poly materials out on the
Market. Yeah, I know that. I mean, you know, most of the people I've talked to that have used them came back and said, wow, it was a lot harder than I thought. So, you know,
exactly.
To really get the consistency there. So, you know, my first thing would be to look for that Adirondack chair because I'll make more money selling it than I will coating it. So,
exactly.
Okay. Do you guys carry the wavy tiles?
You know, I've got a wavy cutting board, or I did at one point. The wavy, if they're talking about the wavy mural, yes, we have that for sure.
Yeah, I think that's what they're referencing here.
That we are actually the inventor of the wavy mural.
Well, then you probably carry it.
We've got it in double sizes of 6-inch and 12-inch.
Okay. So, Jackie, I'm not sure your specific question in regards to that, but Johnson Plastics does carry the wavy towel product, and you may want to contact, by the way, you can see Don's email address down here. You can contact him directly if you have some questions specific to that product. As well, Barbara, I see that you had a question there about something Don had said earlier. I encourage you just to shoot him an email over and get some clarification there. He'll be able to help you out. Can you sublimate on moisture wicking shirts? Absolutely. The moisture wicking doesn't affect the sublimation. In fact, sublimation works fantastic on moisture wicking, but you got to be careful about things like screen printing because screen printing can actually block the cells. So really when you're doing polyester shirts, the ones you really want to sell are the poly performance, which are the moisture wicking, because those are the comfortable ones. If you get old school polyester, I hate that stuff. But if you're talking about poly performance, it's a much more comfortable product, and it also has a much higher perceived value. So, yeah, it sublimates fine. The question was, what's a wavy tile? it's probably because I don't have a picture here. It's probably easier if they just go on the website and do a search on wavy tile mural, or maybe just wavy.
Yeah, or in our catalog, we have it. It's actually a mural. It's not a tile that actually has a curved surface or what have you. The wavy refers to the shape of these tiles when they actually hang.
Right.
And they, you know, they swing back and forth, hence the wave. That would be page 68 in our catalog.
Wow, now that's impressive. Okay, there was a question quite a while back from Sarita about her Epson 1400. And Sarita, based on the information that you're presenting there, I would suggest that you call, if you bought this from Johnson Plastics, I would suggest you call the Johnson Plastics technical support first and talk to them about that, because that becomes something where a lot of questions need to be asked to you. If you did not purchase it from Johnson, then you probably want to call the Sawgrass tech support. You know, we always encourage you to call your dealer first. But if for any reason you can't reach your dealer, you can certainly call us. But go work with tech support, and they should be able to help you resolve that particular question of yours. Can you sublimate two or more ceramic ornaments in the same pressing? Absolutely. You can put as many things you want under that heat press at the same time that fit, provided. Okay? Provided, first of all, that they're the same thickness, because you don't want to put, like, for example, you wouldn't want to put a plaque under there with a T-shirt, because they're so different in thickness, it's going to affect the pressure. So, you know, ideally it's two of the same thing at the same time. Okay, so two ceramic ornaments, sure. Three, four, whatever will fit in there, you can put it under there and do, you know, multiples. And that gives you a little bit more efficiency. You know, instead of you spending one time on each one, if you can get six under there, put six under there. Can you sublimate a magnet like a car magnet? Well, there are sublimatable magnets. I'm assuming you mean the real large one that's like the signage on the side of a car. I don't know if anybody makes a product that big specifically for sublimation.
What we've done is, there was a magnetic material in the past, Jimmy, the Romark product, or meats, yeah. They called it. Nowadays, what people are doing, they're buying the sublet decal that we sell.
Yeah.
And we also sell, on the engraving side, we sell the magnet, so you'll bond the two together, and there's your magnet.
Yep.
Yep, seems to work out really, really, really good.
How about doing ceramic tiles with a clamshell press? Anybody that's ever heard me, you know that my preference is actually a swing away. Though I have a clamshell too. I mean, you know, but what I find with a clamshell, where you have to be careful with a clamshell is really thick substrates, because depending on how they built the clamshell, you know, they differ with different manufacturers. The way that it closes down, because the clamshell is hinged in the back, if it's a real thick item, when you close it down, you may not get equal pressure across the entire surface, especially if it's a fairly large item that's really thick. You know, thinner items, you should have no problem. But sometimes with thicker ones, you could. So, yes, you could do ceramic tiles in a clamshell press. I don't think any of them are too thick to go in a clamshell. But me personally, if I was buying my first heat press from scratch, I would buy a swing away. I just think it works better for some of the thicker items. Does Johnson Plastic sell those 4x6 oval car magnets?
No.
Okay. That's what I thought. But,
4x6 oval. No, back to the decal material again. With the magnetic material, you can make any shape you like or want with the magnet material. Comes in sheets or in rolls.
Right. Okay. How accurate are the expiration dates on the Sawgrass inks? Does it have to be, do you have to use them by the used by date? Only thing I can tell you, and I'll tell you the Sawgrass policy, and if there's anything different from Don, he can certainly tell you. Our policy is that you need to use the ink by the use by date. So I'll leave it at that. Don, I don't know if you have any anything else.
Yeah, that's Sawgrass's policy, and that's actually, we like that policy as well, but you know, at the end of the day, it's not like milk. It's not going to get sour on you tomorrow, but you use it real quick. If something were to start happening, you get some color issues. That's the reason. So, and that's one of the big reasons why Sawgrass says to use it by a use date. I mean, ink does get moldy, so that is one of the big reasons.
There we go. Yeah, you don't want to drink the ink, though, past the date. Okay, I didn't say that. Let's see, can you use chromoblast ink on the metal insert for an iPhone or Galaxy 3 phone covers?
Absolutely not, no.
Yeah, they're designed for sublimation coatings.
Fabric only on the chromoblast.
Yes, chromoblast designed specifically for cotton fabric. Can the Sawgrass cartridge be recycled anywhere? Not to my knowledge currently.
We were at one time recycling, but the recycler says, you know what, this is a plastic and it's a water-based ink. The customer can just put it in their recycle bin weekly and be done with it that way. And that was the stance we took.
Yeah, that's probably the best way to go. I mean, as far as a formal recycling program, we don't currently have one. So, but if that works, that works. All right, so that pretty much wraps up our time for today. And I appreciate everybody with your questions. Don, I appreciate the opportunity to join you and Johnson Plastics today with the presentation. Look forward to doing some more in the future. I know there's some more on the calendar in the future, so coming along. So with that said, I'm going to go ahead and say goodbye to everybody and turn it back over to you, Don.
Well, thanks again, Jimmy. Thanks to everybody. Look forward to hearing from you.